Welcome to Green Time. I'm host Don Fitz. This episode, we're going to be talking about global health care, Venezuela. Before we get into the discussion, let's take a look from the DVD Salud about the Cuban health care system.
Yo era una persona demasiado callada, sumisa en mi casa. Y un día descubrí que existía afuera una vida. Un día estoy leyendo el periódico y sale el anuncio. Se buscan los que quieren estudiar medicina y no sé qué. Y bueno, me guardé el periódico y me lo guardé. Como a las 7 de la noche, 8 de la noche, yo le digo a mi esposa, vamos subiendo para la carnicería. Chico, yo quiero ser médico. Yo le decía, no, Dios mío, ayúdame, ayúdame que yo pueda entrar ahí en eso. Bueno, llegó el 6 de junio. Ese día me llamaron, señorita, venga para que haga la cola, a ver si la dejan presentar el examen. Yo no pude dormir, yo brincaba, saltaba, pasé toda la noche en vela. Me fui a las 4 de la mañana a la entrevista, ya era a las 9 de la mañana. Cuando salimos, mi mamá me dice, ¿pero qué la pasa? Y sale un doctor y me dice, Vanessa, felicitaciones, porque la mayor nota era 100, pero nosotros te dimos 101 en la vida. Bienvenida, estudiante de medicina. Y ese día cambió mi vida.
Eso sí es verdad que es nuevo en Venezuela, que es educar a la población en medicina, educando médicos de altísima calidad en las comunidades. Nosotros necesitamos miles de médicos y lo vamos a crear ¿con quién? Con los médicos cubanos. Pues son 20.000 dedicados a eso.
¿Cómo te sientes, mi amor?
El concepto de la universidad cambia, puesto que ahora la Facultad de Medicina se sale de su pequeño castillo o torre de marfil y se va a las comunidades donde están los médicos trabajando.
Allí el médico barrio adentro es el tutor directo de ese estudiante.
Es posible con este programa formar gran cantidad de profesionales y al mismo tiempo dar acceso a la salud de miles de personas. Por tanto, es un proceso donde ambas partes se benefician.
No hay nada que se parezca a esto en el mundo.
Es la primera vez que llega a la universidad, no nada más al Amazonas, a esa zona del Amazonas.
Estudiante procede de la comunidad y se forma en su comunidad.
Cuando la luz entra, tú ves que en la pupila, en el centro del ojo, se ve algo blanco, ¿ves? Allá atrás. Ese es catarata en ese ojo.
Ellos, para realizar sus estudios, pasan 3 días en el aula y 3 días en el consultorio.
Expandimos el alcance de la educación, la fundimos con las necesidades de la comunidad y el concepto incluso del propio médico también cambia. Puesto que estos estudiantes, como conocen a su gente, van entonces a convertirse en líderes de una medicina además preventiva.
Welcome back to Green Time. I'm host Don Fitz. This episode is about global healthcare, Venezuela. We just saw a clip from the DVD Salud, which is produced in Cuba by the people working on the Cuban healthcare system, talking about how it interfaces with Venezuela. This episode, we're very lucky to have guest Daniel Hellinger. Daniel, you teach at Webster University, is that right?
That's right, Don.
And is it? Give me the department name again. It's a long time.
Oh, it's Department of History, Politics, and International Relations.
Okay. I'm glad you remember that because I sure
do. I have to remind myself once in a while.
Okay. Fantastic. And what's your specialty in studying?
I studied Latin American politics, and I've spent quite a bit of time in Venezuela. I've probably been down there, 15, 20 times over the last 30 years.
So that's a lot. So you've seen a lot of Venezuela.
I've seen a lot of Venezuela since 1978.
Now tell me, was there anything about the DVD that impressed you or that stood out in your mind?
Well, I mean, two things. One is it's an excellent representation of what's going on in Venezuela with healthcare. And if people ever get a chance to see the whole program, they'll really see that this is there's some exciting things happening in other parts of the world too. I would say that in one hand, it strikes me that it's a little bit. It certainly makes Venezuela look like a very nice place to live, and in a lot of ways it is. But there are a lot of problems in Venezuela. And I think they've made enormous progress in dealing with their health care issues. But, you know, we'll probably talk about this a little bit later. There's still some serious issues they've got to overcome.
Right. Now, of course, the DVD is focusing on health care.
Right.
And they're linking up a lot with the Cuban health care system. Mm-hmm. And the Cuban health care system changed health care dramatically because it introduced what's called the family doctors program. Mm-hmm. And the single most revolutionary idea is that the doctors live in the neighborhood,
right,
and so that everybody can go to a doctor where they live, and then the polyclinics link that up, mm-hmm, and then the hospitals are the third level,
right,
of care, and so you don't start off going to the hospital or you don't have a doctor who's far away, and so that's to a large extent that's what the Venezuelans have been doing. Now tell me, what's well known is the Barrio Adentro program,
right?
And the DVD mentioned that, but also there's a whole question of missions in it.
Right.
And what are those? What are missions?
Well, missions is something that President Hugo Chavez came up with. He actually started thinking about this when he was a young officer in the 1980s. And the term mission here has a number of different meanings. Maybe the most important one is a little bit like a military mission, because Chavez had this idea that the military and the civilians should work together to make the country better. So when he got into office,
isn't that a tradition in a lot of Latin American countries that in the United States you think of the military as always being a very conservative force, but haven't a lot of the Latin American revolutions been carried out by a section of the military, which is
well, sometimes I would say sometimes. More often than not, unfortunately, the military is on the other side of revolutionary struggle. But in this particular case, the Venezuelan military, for a number of reasons we probably don't have time to get into, under Chavez, the segment that Chavez led was very progressive, and they were very angry because they felt that the oil revenues, Venezuela is a major exporter of oil, the fourth most important in the world, and that the money was being misspent. That included in the area of healthcare. So when Chavez got elected in 1998, he started making changes and he declared a number of missions. There's one in education, for example, now at all different levels. One was to eradicate literacy. And by the way, they used a lot of Cuban techniques in their successful attempt to do that. The Barrio Adentro, which is called Inside the Barrio. The barrio means a poor neighborhood. Means that in the beginning, the military and civilians would work together to begin to identify the health problems, and then Cubans were invited into the country, partly in exchange for oil. Venezuela provides deeply discounted oil in exchange.
It's a big economic advantage to Cuba as well as Venezuela.
Oh, it's critical to Cuba. Mm-hmm. And so Cuba then sent about 10,000 doctors initially to help Venezuela and live in the barrios. So, you know, the program in the beginning was very dependent upon Cuban doctors and other healthcare workers being willing to live in the barrios.
Well, tell me, how's the program doing today? Because when did this start? About 2002?
Yeah, it started about 2002. Mm-hmm. There was an attempt to overthrow Chavez by the conservative parts of the military, and the people rose up in defense of Chavez. And after that, Chavez decided, well, it's time to accelerate the revolution and time to really deliver to the people who saved my political butt. And so that's when you begin to really see the education, the health, and literacy programs really take off. And there's one thing that the film probably should have touched on that it didn't get to, which is while there are Cuban doctors and actively involved even today in Venezuela, what they also established what they called healthcare committees. And this is where you get the mobilization of the people. So that you had teams of 10, 15 people, some men, mostly women, dressed in red shirts, the color of the revolution, going door to door, knocking on doors. Who lives here? What kind of health care problems do you have? Going into homes, doing an inventory, identifying what the health care needs are. So, I mean, that's a very important component of this. Otherwise, even though Cuban doctors do a better job than, let's say, American doctors would do in the same circumstance, the thing that makes it sustainable and keeps it going today is that they've actively involved Venezuelans as well in carrying out the mission, carrying out of improving health care.
Do you have any idea of how people feel about the doctors going door to door and somebody knocking on your door and basically saying, I want to inspect your house or I want to talk to you?
Most of the people feel very strongly in favor of that. Venezuela had, was one of the wealthier countries in Latin America in the 1970s. The poverty rate had gotten as high as 80%, and the healthcare delivery services were almost non-existent in parts of the city. Well, suddenly you had doctors, nurses, healthcare personnel at these clinics set up in the very poorest parts of the neighborhoods, and doctors going to door and knocking on the doors. And I think, as you may have seen in the clip, in the beginning, I think people were somewhat surprised. Cuban doctors, what are they doing here? Then suddenly they realize, wow, we have health care. So they're very supportive of that. Now, you asked a question a moment ago, though, about whether it's still functioning today, and it still is, but I have to say that there have been some deterioration. Some of those kiosks that you saw in the film, the buildings, have fallen into bad repair. There have been problems. There's a serious problem with crime in the country, and you don't really see that in the film, but it's hard to go out into the neighborhoods and walk around, especially at night, when you have a very serious violent crime problem. So I don't want to cast too much cold water on this, because I think it's wonderful what's happened, and a lot of it's still going very well. But people felt very good about the way things were going, and I think some people are worried about whether or not the services will continue at the same level that they have in the past.
Yeah, I know that must be very difficult for Cuban doctors, because the crime in Venezuela is the violent crime. I mean, there's certainly crime in Cuba. People steal things from me. I had a camera stolen from me in Havana, but I mean, I was never worried about somebody physically attacking me.
Right.
And I've read that some of the Cuban doctors who go to Venezuela are absolutely shocked at the number of attacks.
Yeah, they really are. And again, I don't want to cast too negative a light here, because you have to realize that crime was a problem before Chavez came in. It's gotten worse for a number of reasons, including all the drugs that come out of Colombia and flow through Venezuela on their way to the United States and Europe. So that's a big part of the problem here, which is hard for the Venezuelans to control. But at the same time, Cubans. I just came back. I've been in Cuba this year, and I talked to some Cubans who've been in Venezuela, and they kind of scratched their head and say, we really love the Venezuelans and we're glad we went there, but my goodness, they just don't seem to be able to run things as well as we do.
Dan, we're going to take a break. We are going to take a look at another clip from the DVD, and we'll be right back to the discussion.
Nosotros tenemos en el programa nacional cercano a 17,000 estudiantes.
En miles de pequeños puestos estamos transformando la sociedad desde abajo, con los pobres. Fíjense, no lo estoy transformando para, con.
En la otra parte de mi casa tengo una aula para los estudiantes de medicina. Está donada para ellos estudiar. Aquí está estudiando mi hijo y algunos compañeros de él, de la misma vecindad.
Me acuerdo que cuando empezaron las clases, yo decía, Dios mío, ¿será que yo voy a poder con esto? Y dictaron la primera conferencia y fueron 17 hojas que copié. Y mi libro, Un Jesucristo, que muchos se burlan porque era un Jesucristo, un libro así que me tuve que leer en una semana. Yo decía, yo no puedo con esto.
Ella se trasladó para la parte mía.
¿Cómo me dijiste que se llamaba luego? Sé que son unas varices.
Fue una relación un poco, porque ella decía que yo tenía un carácter muy fuerte, no quería estar conmigo. Si sale mal en un día, en lo que sea, sabe que ella solita viene para que yo la regañe. Pero me siento muy contento por su capacidad como estudiante. Es una de las mejores que tenemos en la microrregión.
¿Qué le puede ocasionar a él la tensión ocular?
La pérdida de la visión.
Yo siempre le, a pesar de que sea un buen estudiante, le exijo todos los días, para que cada día sea mejor. Y que este el lugar que le tocará a ella en un futuro, ocupar esta parte que nosotros estamos.
Desde el primer día dijeron, no, que tienen que comenzar a llevar las batas y no sé qué, y la única que no llevaba la bata era yo. Entonces, el doctor Ovaldo, mi tutor, me decía, Vanessa, la bata, Vanessa, la bata. Y me tenía, pero hasta aquí.
La bata es el honor de nosotros los médicos.
Ese era uno de los motivos por el que yo lo odiaba a él.
Porque a todos los estudiantes yo le exijo la bata.
Donde él me veía,
le digo,
decía,
donde
la
esté
bata,
un estudiante, le decía, usted no tiene la bata, entonces vaya a buscarla.
Se tiene que ir de la consulta. Un día yo me paré y le digo, ¿sabes qué, Osvaldo? Yo no estoy diciendo que no me quiero poner la bata, que no me la voy a poner. Yo me voy a poner la bata cuando yo sienta que me la merezco y que me la voy a poner para toda la vida. Y así fue, pasó el curso, llegó el día final, llegó el día de entregar las notas y bueno, felicitaciones, ¿te ha pasado con esto? ¿Se fue seleccionada para esto, esto y esto? Y dijo, hoy me pongo mi bata. Bajé, compré mi bata y subí para aquí Osvaldo. Osvaldo, hoy 11 de octubre me gané el derecho de ponerme mi bata. Pónmemela. La lloré, la bailé, la lavé, la planché. Y es mía y no me la quito para nada.
Welcome back to Green Time. I'm host Don Fitz. I am here with Daniel Hellinger of Webster University, who's with the Department of History, Politics.
Oh, yeah. Let's just say Webster University.
Webster University. Okay. So we just saw another clip from the DVD, Salute, which is about healthcare, the Cuban international healthcare effort. And this section is focused in on Venezuela. One of the things that I've never been to Venezuela, but I've been to Cuba three times. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I noticed when I was in Cuba and talking to medical school students, all of them were young.
Right.
They were all, some of them, the non-Americans were right out of high school. Mm-hmm. In most of Latin America, there's no concept that you go to school for 4 years till you mm-hmm. go to medical school. When you're 17 or 18, you're ready to go to medical school, if that's your profession. But in Venezuela, and in Cuba, they also go to school in Havana or Santiago, which is on the other side of the mm-hmm. island. But what they describe in Venezuela is that there's medical schools all over the country.
Right.
And I think the woman who was in medical school has two children that they right. focused on in the DVD. And I've talked to many people going to medical school in Cuba, and I've never talked to a single student who had children. They were all...
Yeah. I think you'll see a few more students, younger students, coming in now because some of the education mm-hmm. programs that take mm-hmm. people up, they started with literacy, they built up the secondary school, they now have a Bolivarian University. So you will see, I think, some change in that. But I think right now, for the last 5 or 6 years, you have to understand that in the barrios, in the poor neighborhoods of Venezuela, some people say that you only have madres y hijos, mothers and sons. In other words, you don't have husbands and daughters. And what that means is that men are favored, but women hold the community together. Mm-hmm. And I think it's quite logical that what you saw in the film with the young woman who decided she was going to go and learn mm-hmm. to be a doctor is that what you're seeing in Venezuela is that a lot of the missions, a lot of the social programs rely very heavily upon women who really hold things together in the poor neighborhoods. So mm-hmm. it's not too surprising that at least at this stage, the people who decide, I'm going to go out and I'm going to do more are the women. They really are the backbone mm-hmm. of these programs, not just the health programs, but the education programs, mm-hmm. The land redistribution programs, the nutrition programs. There are men involved, but women really are the backbone.
And that really came through loud and clear in the DVD in the interview with the woman there mm-hmm. because she talked a lot about how she had to make the decision about going to medical school. She had to make the decision about wearing the bata, which is the mm-hmm. white coat
right.
that doctors wear. And she did, even though she knew she had two children, there was no discussion of asking her husband if she could have permission to do that.
I had a smile at that. It was so Venezuelan. I mean, I've been in Cuba and Venezuela, and they're wonderful. People are wonderful. And when you, but she is so, her exuberance and her enthusiasm is so Venezuelan.
Okay, well, tell me, in October 2011, mm-hmm. there's going to be an election.
2012, yeah.
I forgot what year. Okay, 2012, there's going to be an election for president yeah. Of Venezuela. Now, what do you think, if Hugo Chavez's role were to yeah. change in the Bolivarian Revolution, do you think it could change? And what do you think, could that affect the healthcare
yeah,
system?
This is the really big wild card in mm-hmm. really all the programs in mm-hmm. Cuba, because Chavez probably will
Venezuela.
Win. Thank you. Wrong year, wrong country. It really could. If Chavez, he might like to be president of Cuba too, but it's not going to work. He's probably going to win in October, but it's not sure. There is an opposition, and the opposition's made some gains in elections in recent years. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing is that Hugo Chavez last year was diagnosed with cancer. Now, he mm-hmm. said he's overcome it, and he's going to be cancer-free, but you never know. So so many of these programs rely upon him. Now, if the opposition wins, it's interesting. 5 years ago, they were all saying they were going to get rid of all the Cuban doctors. They were going to get rid of all the programs. Now, all of a sudden, they're saying we're going to make them run better. Now, the thing is...
I've read that. That's interesting. I mean, they were so... The conservatives in Venezuela were so hostile to the Cubans coming in
right.
that they said, kill Cuban doctors. And that didn't go over very well in the barrios, didn't it?
No, although I must say that most of the people running right now were not that extreme. Oh, but nonetheless...
There were a few people like that.
Yeah, they're kind of technocrats. Oh, yeah, more than a few. But they're kind of technocrats, you know? Mm-hmm. I don't think they understand how much the people component that we've seen in the film matters. That this is not just about repairing the clinics or making sure that people have the proper licenses and professional training. Mm-hmm. This is also about the relationship between the doctors and the people. Now, what they have going for them is that in some parts of the country, as I mentioned before, including some of the very poor neighborhoods, some of these programs are not operating with the efficiency that they really were at the beginning. And in other places, they're working splendidly. And sort of the danger here is that people might be fooled into thinking that, oh, we'll have the same programs, but with just people who know more about how to run things well doing it. And I don't think that's what's going to happen.
In other words, the right wing might think that, well, we're going to go along with these programs, but they want to have when they say have them run better, right. they would get rid of the political enthusiasm.
Well, the other thing they would do is that, of course, they would probably cut Cuba. They would stop sending oil to Cuba. I mean, this is not just humanitarian. It is partly. Mm. It's humanitarian in Venezuela's part, too, to provide Cuba with deeply discounted oil. But Cuba gets about 150,000 barrels a day from Venezuela, which is pretty much what it needs. Mm. They'll start pumping their own oil in all probability in a year or two. But right now, Venezuela is their lifeline. And if a new government came in and cut off the oil, then all of a sudden, of course, the Cubans, you know, are no longer sending doctors, perhaps. Mm-hmm. So actually, that might give the opposition some pause about moving so quickly, because I think people will react. If the opposition comes in and these programs begin to really try to pull them back, I think people have learned in the Chavez era that they have a right to be included. They have a right to health care, a right to education, something we hope people in this country will stand up for more in the coming years.
So it would be even more socially disruptive than, say, ending Social Security
Absolutely.
In the United States. It would just cause...
Oh, yeah.
If the conservatives in Venezuela had a backlash against Chavez by eliminating the medical program, then there would be a backlash against that backlash.
Exactly.
And it would be very, very disruptive.
Right.
Okay. Well, Dan, we only have about 2 minutes left for the show. What do you think would be the most important issues that are anything that we've left out that you would like to cover?
Well, I would say only that, you know, when we think about these programs, we look at them and we say, oh my goodness, you know, that's so different than here. And it is, of course. I'd like to think that at some point in our own country, people are going to take a close look at the medical care system, and not just at whether we all should have medical insurance, but whether or not we couldn't have the kinds of programs. These young doctors, we know that we have young doctors that are Americans being trained in Cuba, and they're going to come back. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we had thousands of them coming back, working in poor communities, bringing this kind of healthcare system, this holistic, community-based, participatory healthcare system to our country? I think it can happen, but I have to admit, it looks a long way off.
I think it would be extremely, the thing that would make it most difficult is that the cornerstone of the programs both in Cuba and Venezuela are people living in the community.
Right.
And how many American doctors would be willing to live in the community where they serve, and how many Americans...
Which was a major problem in Venezuela, of course. Right. Just like in Cuba when they started the program, the doctors don't want to live in those communities. I have to say, would I go? I mean, you know, it's easy for me to sit here and say, oh, they should all go live in the barrios.
But they were able to recruit thousands, in both countries, they were able to recruit thousands and thousands of young people who, starting at the age of 16 or 17, said, I want to go to medical school and do this.
That's right. You're absolutely right.
And so there, what I guess we're saying is that you can't really separate medicine from the whole social changes that are going on in a country.
Exactly.
In other words, you can't preserve the whole social structure of a country and then just change medicine. Dan, I'm getting the wrap-up sign.
Okay.
So I want to thank you tremendously for coming to this issue of Green Time. I want to thank everybody for tuning into Green Time, and I want to invite you to tune in again next week.